Hello. So today we have with us Professor Gettu, Professor Ravindra Gettu. He is a professor in the Department of Civil Engineering here at IIT Madras. He has a PhD from Northwestern University in Evanston, the United States of America. And he works on concrete technology. He is also the Associate Dean for Industrial Consultancy and Sponsored Research at IIT Madras. So he has a lot of experience working with various funding agencies, working with various sponsoring agencies and so on. And so has a very good insight into what are the kinds of activities that go on as in the institute as a whole, and certainly with respect to civil engineering. So first of all, welcome to this interview. And so we'd just like to start with civil engineering. I mean, most of us realize that, you know, it's been around for a long time. And in fact, wherever I go, the thing that comes to my mind is that, you know, the first people who arrived here were civil engineers because the road is already there and the building is already there. So what are traditional areas of civil engineering that people do research on but have been around for a very long time as areas of research?
Well, first of all, thank you for having me here. It's good that people are interested in civil engineering. A lot of times we think people take civil engineering for granted and they don't think any research goes on. Well, at least in our department, in most of the places, we would have, say, four or five major areas of civil engineering. Structural engineering, which deals with the construction of facilities like buildings, bridges, and so on. And then we have geotechnical engineering, which deals with foundation, how these structures are built on, the mechanics of soils, and how safe should the foundation be. Then we have environmental engineering, which deals with how people and constructed facilities affect and interact with the environment. We have water resources, or what can be also called hydraulic engineering, which deals with facilities like canals, dams, and water supply, as well as say sewage networks and sanitary networks. Then we have transportation engineering, which I'm sure anybody who has used any road or any system of transportation in our country understands the intricacy and the complications. So they deal with how to make traffic flow better, viability of different systems, and they also look into the future to see how planning should be done. Then we have a group such as ours, where I come from, which deals with construction management and management of projects, and to make them more efficient, safer, cost effective, and delivered on time. We also deal with materials technologies. That's particularly what I do. I work on concrete and other construction materials. Then we also have a group which works on building physics, like to make sure that our buildings are more comfortable. Ventilation, thermal, comfort, and lighting. So these are the different aspects. So in each of these areas, there's a lot of research which goes on. So I'm sure that anyone who's interested in research in civil engineering would find an area that is suitable for. Okay.
In this range of activities that you were mentioning, is there something that's relatively recent that has come on that people have gotten on to in, let's say, in the last 10-15 years, as opposed to something that's been around for a much longer period of time?
Well, civil engineering as such, like you you said in the introduction, has been around. There are a lot of new things coming in. I work in materials, so the first thing that comes to mind is the new type of materials which are coming in. Polymers are being used extensively in civil engineering. Civil engineering materials were traditionally stone and brick and cement mortar and so on. So, but the polymers are coming in very big. Then other technologies, for example, information technology is affecting a lot how we model and how we predict anything going from traffic flow to how a structure behaves and what are the interactions of environment on a structure. Environmental engineering has become very big now. In it, this boom in environmental engineering, I would say, started off long back in other countries. In India, maybe much later. But in the past decade, we've seen so much of research in environmental engineering within the realm of civil engineering. So there is a lot of lot of studies being done on how to make our water supply safer and how to make sure that the waste that we generate is treated well and disposed of in safe conditions.
Okay.
So there are a lot of things coming up.
Okay. So when students come to your department for their postgraduate degree, so they all typically would have some kind of undergraduate degree on related to civil engineering, and they come, most of them, I assume. Maybe you do take students from other backgrounds too. Are there some common issues that they face in settling into a research environment, coming from a course related environment, which is what they would have done during undergrad? Or even otherwise, just settling into the kind of research activities that go on in a advanced civil engineering department. Are there any specific issues that they tend to face?
Well, generally they don't face any major problems. One thing that comes up often is the way that they have studied in their bachelor's or sometimes even in the master's is not really amenable to how we expect research to be done. To give an example, lot of students have studied answers for specific questions, and then what we find out is they are not able to analyze new situations, or when we have them do research, they expect or they seem to feel that it would be a series of steps where the guide tells them to do this and they come back. But when we expect them to analyze the results, we find that to be lacking. And this comes back to the fact that when they have studied, they've always been told to study a certain set of answers for a certain set of questions. Out of those questions, they are examined.
Mm-hmm.
So we find out that sometimes that analysis or the ability to handle new type of questions, new type of problems is lacking. So we spend better part of the first year bringing the students up to this level that we require.
Okay.
And I would say most of the students who finish say their PhD or their master's now go out with the ability that we expect in a good researcher.
Okay. So, okay, in general, as they leave the institution with a degree, are there ways that you feel are the appropriate ways to measure success in their research activity? Of course, they are getting a degree, so they have succeeded in some way. But is there something more subtle that you look at and you say, this person was a successful researcher?
Well, how I would judge a researcher, say a PhD student still at IIT, is if that person has the ability to analyze.
Okay.
And decide, reach decisions based on their results or their research, I think they are good researchers.
Okay. Great.
The proof of the pudding is when they graduate and go out, and if we follow their career, I would expect that say in 5-10 years, they should be one of the top researchers in India. Then we are successful in in our work in bringing them out as researchers.
Very nice. So I think, in fact, talking about what happens when students leave the degree program, after they graduate.
Mm-hmm.
So of course, civil engineering is very well connected with the industry. There's a direct link between what you do and maybe what a very large fraction of industry out there, construction industry, looks for. So that link, I think most of us understand. Are there other industries which pick up civil engineers where maybe the general public may be not as aware of it? Is there some unique situations like that you can tell us about?
Well, in our country, most of our PhD students go into teaching.
Okay.
I would say about 90% or more of our PhD students would go into teaching. Lot of our master's students, those who do MS as well as MTech, go into the industry. So they have been people going from chemical manufacturers up to structural designers. So the whole range and whatever we deal with, there are people who go into the industry. And in terms of PhD, as I mentioned, the openings that they get into are mostly in teaching. But we have had students who go into administration, say. We have people who go into the IAS, IES. We have students who have gone into the IFS, Indian Forest Service. So, somehow civil engineering seems to give them a holistic view, which they hope will be useful to them when they go into administration.
Okay, very nice. So maybe some a bit of a mundane question now, coming off of these more philosophical questions. So students come in and they become graduate students here for maybe say 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, depending on their degree program. They go through various phases of, you know, learning courses, doing research and so on. What do you think is the frequency with which students should meet their advisors, and you know, what would you, can you give us some, you know, input into the kind of interaction that a guide and a student should have through the course of their PhD?
Well, it's sort of a difficult question to give a generic answer. Mm-hmm. I would say they should meet the guide as often as necessary.
Okay.
Now, as a thumb rule, I think once a week is good enough.
Okay.
Once a week is good enough. I don't like students to come in every day and ask what they should be doing.
Okay.
And I think that doesn't show their independence, and I think the guide also should not be doing this. But once a week at least is a good frequency, and towards the end of the thesis, when the thesis has to be corrected, I think more often would be good.
Okay.
Now, this interaction could be in groups. I know research groups like mine, where we have a research meeting of the whole group every week. So the interaction could be in a group or could be on one-on-one,
okay,
depending on the student and I would say the guide.
Okay. So maybe we'll close with this question. What advice would you give to an aspiring research student in your department?
Well, I think the most important thing that I would say, and this is something that I ask students, say in their comprehensive exam or research proposal, I ask students, how is your thesis going to make the world a better place? This often we don't think, how is the thesis going to be important? So I expect students to believe in themselves, believe in the problem, and believe in the solution, and know what we are going to solve. So okay, this is something that sometimes students are caught by surprise.
Okay.
And this comes back when I was doing my master's. I was working on a problem I thought was very exciting. And when I was applying for a PhD, somebody asked me, what is the use of what you're doing?
Okay.
And that made me think. I went back to my advisor and said, why am I doing this? Where can I apply this? So I always ask my students and I tell them, pick up a problem or work on something that is going to have some effect in some way, and understand that and work towards it. And that, I think, makes it more pleasant, and I think holistically that's the better way.
With the or big more picture. Fulfilling too.
Okay. Certainly.
Yeah. So thank you, Professor Getty.
Sure.
Thank you for joining us.
Okay.
Pleasure.
Thanks, Pratap.
Thank you.